to say that. And so those are all the things that we talk about when I'm talking to patients about modifiable things. So what about the gut microbiome? So the gut microbiome is the bacteria that live inside. And they live in our GI tract. Mostly they're bacteria, but they're also fungi and it's estimated that all human cancer is linked to chronic inflammation. And in the gut, there are more bacteria than there are cells of our own origin. So we are really nothing but a vessel holding bacteria, if you look at it that way. And the bacteria that we have inside us can predispose us to cancer. So you may know that gastric ulcers have been linked to this particular bacteria, Helicobacter pylorus. And there is a, we know that inflammation in the GI tract is linked to cancer because people with Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, can get predisposition to colon cancer. And we wonder, is bacterial colitis something that can do that too? So this is a picture of the ulcers in a person's mouth. So these are the teeth. Here's an ulcer here, caused by this bacteria called Fusobacterium maculata. Now it's also in your GI tract, and it causes ulcers like that in the GI tract, which leads to inflammation, and it's been linked to colorectal cancer. And when you have Fusobacterium in primary tumors, it's also seen in liver metastases, so it populates the liver metastases, and it's associated with a worse prognosis. So you lose this barrier function. You know, you want the bacteria to stay in the GI tract in the lumen, not in the wall, where it can cause the ulcers that I showed you. Antibiotics in mouse models can reduce colon cancer incidence. What we eat and, of course, what antibiotics we take influences this. And so potentially probiotic bacteria that you can get like Lactobacillus acidophilus, you can buy as a supplement to milk, may make a difference. Now, there were just three big articles in Science magazine this week, which is one of the major medical journals, about the gut microbiome and its influence on disease. But it's something that we're still learning about, and we're not ready to try manipulating it. We don't know how to manipulate it yet, but we will in time. So causing inflammation can lead to cancer. It also can change drug metabolism and toxicity. It varies with what we put in our body, and it can be influenced potentially by either antibiotics or probiotics. So let's talk a little bit about surgery. So radiation is not something we use all that frequently in colorectal cancer. We use it in rectal cancer patients, but not so much in colon cancer patients. But we're now starting to use it to treat metastatic disease. And standard radiation, takes about 25 to 30 treatments. Anybody in the room got 30 treatments for, okay? And you get to week 5 in that. Conventional hypofractionation actually gives stereotactic radiation, which gives 1 to 3 treatments for metastatic disease. And this is a picture of a physicist's dosing program for a patient with a lung metastasis. So this is the rib cage. This is the tumor. With stereotactic radiation, you bring beams in from many different areas. That way you minimize the damage to healthy tissue and you maximize the damage to the tumor tissue. And you can give fewer treatments with fewer side effects. So this is actually a picture of a patient with a liver tumor. That's the bright spot here. Here it is again on a PET scan. And after getting stereotactic radiation, that lesion disappears. So we're using that increasingly in patients with limited metastatic disease. So here's an example of a collection of patients, 427 patients. Some of them had more than one liver metastasis, 25 centers in Europe. They got SBRT, their two-year local control rate, 70%, median overall survival, 27 months. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about PD-1 inhibitors, immunotherapy, and this has the potential to work well with PD-1 inhibitors. So I'll talk to you about that. And those of you who wonder what robotic surgery is, this is what it looks like. So it doesn't look like the Tin Man's in the operating room with you. Instead, this contraption is, and this is a patient's abdomen with these things in there. It looks pretty scary with your sleep. So. And, you know, if you're yelling, you can be a robotic surgeon. Because this is the guy operating. Doesn't have gloves on, isn't touching the patient, looking in a console, and this is what he's doing to operate. And so this decreases the amount of incision you need, it decreases the recovery time, and it does good work in terms of surgery. It does take longer to do robotic surgery, but it's a shorter hospital stay and a better complication rate. So people like to know about immuno-oncology. Some of the older people in the room will recognize this from Mad Magazine, Spy versus Spy. We seem to be talking more about the Cold War again in recent days. These two guys were looking for invaders back in the 60s when Mad Magazine came out. And the invaders, of course, were spies, so they tried to cloak themselves and hide. And that is pretty much the story about immune therapy in colon cancer. So, tumors are mutated versions of our own DNA, and our immune system doesn't want to reject our own DNA because that causes autoimmune disease like Crohn's disease or rheumatoid arthritis. Tumor cells have more abnormal surface proteins because of the DNA makes abnormal proteins on tumor cells. And different tumors have different frequencies. So these abnormal proteins can be recognized by our lymphocytes and essentially uncloak the tumor to the immune system. But in general, these T lymphocytes will not recognize tumors as abnormal, and so they don't see the spies in our system. So our immune system has really evolved to kill foreign invaders, bacteria, viruses, and funguses. If it's too sensitive, we get autoimmune disease, and the challenge, therefore, is to get our immune system to see tumor cells as foreign invaders and destroy them. And that is what is happening now. So this is a sign of different mutations for tumors. So for example, chronic myelogenous leukemia has one mutation in the BCR-ABL gene, and it has one drug that reverses that mutation called imatinib that essentially helps every single patient. Colon cancer isn't like that. In what we call mismatch repair tumors, which are the tumors that are caused by Lynch syndrome, where people inherit a defective spell check, there are thousands of mutations. I'm going to skip that. We did a study that was funded by Swim Across America. I'm going to make a comment about that in a minute, using a PD-1 inhibitor called pembrolizumab. And we did it in mismatch repair deficient patients, those with Lynch syndrome, patients who didn't have Lynch syndrome, and then in non-colorectal cancer patients. And I'm just going to give a shout out to Swim Across America. As government funding for research goes down, we're more and more dependent on charities, and this charity funded this study. Now, each one of these lines is a patient, and here are all the patients that got responses. And in the mismatch repair proficient patients, there were very few responses. They're the red ones. In the mismatch repair deficient patients, there were many responses, and some of them were long-lasting. So each line here represents an individual patient, and this is the patient you want to be down here. Now, this is another interesting thing. This is a biopsy of one of the patients, and this is a biopsy from a second patient. All this blue stuff is cancer. When we treated the patients and biopsied again, there was no cancer. But there still was a lot of tissue there, and this confuses us sometimes when we're trying to determine if somebody's responding to these treatments, because the tumors don't necessarily go away, but they don't have cancer anymore. And so that's made our lives a bit more challenging. And then the other thing is, in the non-colorectal cancer patients, we saw some responses if they had deficient mismatch repair, And I'll just call your attention to pancreatic cancer, which has been terribly resistant to treatment. But 5 or 6 patients responded. And here you can see the rainbow. Each one of these colors represents a different kind of cancer. And this treatment worked in all patients with instability or defective mismatch repair. The duration of the response is long. Some of these patients may actually be cured even though they have metastatic disease. Now, the trouble is that in time, these drugs can cause autoimmune disease and inflammation, and so we're learning how to deal with that. The last thing I want to talk to you about is that we're doing much more genomics on patients, and we're looking at DNA, RNA, and proteins that are abnormal in tumors, and I'm going to show you just 2 tumor types that we've done. One is called the NCI MATCH study. 6,000 patients all had genomics testing, 93% success with the genomic testing. 1,000 will participate in 30 different studies that target specific abnormalities that are identified by the genomic testing. And actually, you can see here that the largest percentage of patients that successfully went on to enroll in this new type of study were colorectal cancer patients. And then this is another study that's similar, which is smaller in scale. So the last thing I want to talk to you about is there have been ups and downs in the NIH budget. Last year at this time, the White House announced they were going to cut the NIH budget by 27%, and all of us had nightmares and sleepless nights that are in the business of doing cancer research and any medical research. And they were going to cap what are called indirect costs, which we get at research institutions to help support our research. But then 3 months later, the Senate actually increased the NIH funding. And then the president came out with his budget, and it looked like he was going to cut NCI funding, but then there was an addendum. So there's this sort of waffling on what's going on in the White House and what the White House's attitude has applied to cancer as well. In addition, with respect to insurance issues, you don't get access to care in the same way if you don't have insurance. They're looking at cutting drug reimbursement. They're looking at getting rid of the 340B pricing, which for places like my hospital in West Virginia, which has a higher incidence of uninsured and underinsured patients, is critical. Reduction in Medicaid payments and elimination of CDC things for tobacco and mammograms and cap tests to the under and uninsured. So I'm going to finish and then open this up to questions. I will tell you that there is lots of progress being made in the treatment of colorectal cancer. To those of you in the room that are fighting it may seem like the pace of progress is not fast enough to satisfy you. And the way to help with that is to go call on Congress and tell your representatives your story and why they need to be supporting cancer research and insurance coverage. Circulating DNA, as I said, has a potential to assign risk and modify treatment approaches. If any of you have a Big Mac tomorrow for lunch, I want you to think about this talk while you're having it. We're learning about risk and outcomes, but not ready to make recommendations. We're getting some new technology that's helping us do better things. And immuno-oncology is expanding options for a small subset of our patients. We're trying to figure out through research ways to apply that to a bigger slice of colorectal cancer patients. And genomics is complicated. We're just learning how to exploit it. I ran a session at our ASCO meeting called Coincidence of Interest Rather than Conflict of Interest, because I think the public pharmaceutical companies, academia, and patients all should be working together on these things because we all care about making progress. Supporting NIH and NCI will help us make progress, and of course, if you can't get here, you heard from some of our colleagues in the UK and Europe that certain drugs that we consider standard here, like bevacizumab, are not available there, you can't benefit from it. And that's an issue here as well as it is in Europe. So I'm going to stop there, and I'd be happy to take some questions. Looks like there are a few.
I'm also someone who doesn't need a microphone. I was curious. I'm really tall, so I don't want to stand up. Intimidate everyone.
I'm taller than you, and I'm up here.
So I'm curious about your opinions on using ctDNA for reoccurrence. So I personally have had a lot of experience where I wanted to do this test to see, you know, my chances of, am I really NED or, you know, is it about to come back any day now? But I was told at multiple places, Mayo, MSK, and Hopkins, and my home hospital, University of Colorado, that no oncologist will act on a positive ctDNA when you are in NED status. So I'm curious as to, and then, you know, they came back from ASCO, this was before ASCO, and they came back and said, you know, we still can't move on that. So I'm just curious, because this has also been a heated topic in colon town. I know Erica is here somewhere. So I'm curious, just your perspective, having been to ASCO, it's kind of the potential of what you would say to your patients that are looking towards that in terms of reoccurrence. Because I see that study and it makes me think, oh, that's a good, you know, you should go get it done so you know if it's going to come back.
So now I'll repeat again that ASCO just came out with a policy statement on this saying ctDNA isn't ready for prime. And you know, the study I showed you is one of the largest studies. It was 45 patients. It looks really promising, but people aren't really sure what to do with it. And we always have this yin and yang of, is a new technology ready for general use versus, can I have it? I need it. You know, I've got colon cancer and I want to know if it's back. And what I would say are there are these things, even though we're not quite sure what they mean. It doesn't surprise me that you've talked to a bunch of different centers and they said, we can get this bit of data, but we don't know how to use this bit of data, so it isn't going to change how we think of you. I understand that that's not particularly emotionally satisfying to somebody in your circumstance. If you came to me, I would probably tell you that I wouldn't know what to do with the data point, so I don't think I should do a test that I don't know how to interpret. But stay tuned.
On top of stage 4 colon cancer, I also have type 2 diabetes. And I understand that there's been some studies on the impact of metformin on colorectal cancer. Can you talk to that?
Well, so those studies have mainly been retrospective studies, looking at groups of patients that have taken metformin and noting that they have a lower incidence of colon cancer. Now, it's hard to give metformin to people that don't have diabetes, because it causes reductions in blood sugar. So there haven't really been prospective studies on it. It's correlation, but we never are sure whether correlation is implicated with causality. If I had type 2 diabetes and colon cancer, I'd want to be on metformin. Are you?
I am.
All right. Next.
Age 35 now, but I've heard and you confirmed that the estrogen can lead to more cancer, breast cancer. I decided to do the natural hormone replacement. So how long is a safe time to be on hormone replacement, and is there a big difference in the natural versus the traditional hormone replacement?
So I'm not qualified really to speak like an endocrinologist, but in general, the answer is yes. If you're taking Premarin, you know, that is pure estrogen, and you can be taking pure progesterone. Most of the supplements that you take are plant estrogens, and they're different. They still have some of the
fantastic job of covering the wide breadth of information. I have